You'll get the sense from the start of my story that there are certain mistakes that I made, and I want to talk to you about those mistakes. Now, mistake number one is blindly trusting an agency without doing your own research. And that's essentially what happened to me. I didn't do my own research. And so your research might involve finding someone called a trailblazer. And I talked about this in my video. A trailblazer is basically someone, preferably from your country, same background, same medical school, that already made it to the UK and is already working there. So they've kind of burned that path and you just have to follow that path. And the benefits of finding a trailblazer is that they will have made those mistakes already and you don't have to make those mistakes. And the second benefit of finding a trailblazer is that they will give you an idea of the time scales that you are dealing with. Because I mean, if registering with the GMC will take weeks and weeks, then essentially there's no point sitting in the UK waiting for that to happen because you're just paying for rent and you're just burning money. And so a good example is when I went to Australia a few years ago, obviously. I found a trailblazer. I was really lucky. She was a GP also from Manchester that ended up in Australia. And so she told me all the tips and tricks and the mistakes to avoid, but she also gave me those timescales. And she's like, Mike, it's going to be 3 months for you to get your registration in Australia. And so you have to decide, you know, do you have 3 months worth of savings to live in Australia? And so obviously when you come to a different country, it's exciting, right? So I want to go to Alton Towers. I want to see, you know, all these cool things. I want to go to concerts. I want to enjoy life. Well, if you're not working, you're burning money. So essentially that's mistake number one, find a trailblazer. And realistically, a locum agency can be a trailblazer for you. Because I'll tell you something about locum agencies and I'll be telling you the pros and cons of locum agencies. But essentially, locum agencies have a vested interest in you getting that job because that's how they get paid. So when you start working in your post, then the hospital or the GP practice, that's when they pay the agency. So they'll have a lot of pathways. They'll have a lot of protocols that they can kind of push you through. So they know about GMC registration. They know about language tests and that kind of thing. They know about getting references. Obviously, the agency that I was with, they didn't tell me that I need UK experience. I had to find that out from someone else. So yeah, that's the idea also of this webinar, just to give you guys some advice. Let's talk about the pros and cons of agencies. As I said, the pros are that they can be your trailblazer if you don't find anyone. But a piece of advice that I would give you, and this applies to life in general, and you might already know this. Obviously, I didn't know this because I come from like a very sheltered medical background. But yeah, in life, if you want anything sorted or you need to hire someone, always get 3 quotes. So if you're looking for a plumber, you're looking for a builder, get 3 quotes. Get an idea of who it is you're speaking with, what they have on offer, and how much they're paying you. And so I wouldn't, as IMGs, guys, don't feel any loyalty to any locum agencies. Just go to 3 different ones, say, yeah, I want a job, and then just choose the one you want. Do you know what I mean? That's also what I did when I was going to Australia. I went to 3 different locum agencies, and I chose the one that I liked the most. Those are the pros of having a locum agency or getting in touch with a locum agency. Now, some of the cons is that they might not have the best jobs on offer. What I mean by that is the job that I'm currently in as a GP, as a salary GP in Manchester, is a brilliant job. I love my job. I love the practice I work in. I love the team there. My contract is very good and my pay is very good. And so when they were hiring, they didn't have to go to an agency. They basically used word of mouth. And within 3 days, they had 10 eager GPs willing to take that post. And so sometimes when hospitals or when GP practices become desperate, because for whatever reason, they can't find a doctor to work there, and there may be many, many reasons why they can't find a doctor to work there, they will then go to an agency. And then that agency can sort things out for you. Now, I'm going to just give you an example. When I qualified as a GP, obviously, I studied in Poland, so I speak Polish. I got a job offer from Scunthorpe. Now, for those of you that aren't from the UK, you might not know where Scunthorpe is, but it's in the middle of Yorkshire, and it's kind of deprived. So I'm not saying it's not a great place to live. I mean, there are probably people in Scunthorpe who are actually very, very happy in Scunthorpe. So they're like, Mike, Have you heard of a golden handshake? So I'm going to tell you what a golden handshake is. It's basically this, and wrapped in gold. So what that means is they give you a lump sum upfront just to go there, and the lump sum was actually quite big. So it was, I think it was 10 or 20,000 pounds on top of my GP salaried. They're like a salary. So essentially, what they said is, just come here, stay here for a few years, and here's 20K. And I go, 20K. What can I do with 20K? I probably can't buy a Tesla. I think Teslas are too expensive, but maybe I could get like a Volkswagen or something. So I had the choice, do I go to Scunthorpe, spend a few years there, or do I stay in Manchester and maybe not get 20,000 pounds? So I ended up staying in Manchester. We're going to talk about that in another mistake that I made. But yeah, that's something that you have to bear in mind. They might not have the best jobs. And so when you look at the jobs on offer, you will see different price ranges. Do you know what I mean? And so if you see like a job that's like pays really, really, really well, just ask that question to yourself. How come this job pays so well? Is it because no one wants to work there? And if they don't want to work there, why? Okay. So that's kind of mistake number one. Now, in terms of mistake number two, let's go back to when I get this job as a night house officer in Warrington. So super excited. I was so excited. I kind of got into the hospital and then I'm there, I'm all alone, and I have a list like this of jobs to do. I'm like, I have no idea how to do anything. And what I mean by that is like they expect you to manage patients. You will have some kind of support that will be there somewhere, but no one's hand holding you. And so essentially, even medical students in the UK, they are very much prepared for this. And so in their last year of med school, they're kind of mini junior doctors. So they're managing patients on their own. And so essentially, I was lost. It was like the worst shift ever. I mean, I did get paid for it, but man, they hated me because I didn't know how to do anything. And I just kept on asking and asking and asking. And so, tip number two, or mistake number two, is realize that in the UK, there are these things called guidelines. There are these things called protocols and pathways. And Brits love those kind of things. And that's one of the cool things of living in the UK. The idea is that everything is really kind of straightforward and it's all step by step. And so, you have to understand that the UK has certain guidelines. Essentially, that is what my audiobook is about. It is basically just guidelines, just to get you ready for your first shifts. And so, guidelines have another benefit. They can give you an amazing sense of comfort, because you'll have the confidence to know exactly what to do with the patient in front of you. And I mean, I went to medical school in Poland. I don't consider myself an idiot. so yeah, because I didn't fail any medical school exams. I even had a scholarship in medical school because my grades were so high. So I went through the program that they wanted me to go to, but then I ended up in hospital and it's like, I have no idea how to be a doctor. So I mean, I knew a lot about like the Krebs cycle. I knew a lot about embryology. I just didn't know how to be a doctor. So I didn't know what a UTI was. I didn't know how to treat it. And so that's what you have to transition into. You have to understand that the UK has amazing guidelines and they're all evidence-based, and just familiarize yourself with them. So that was the second mistake, knowing about guidelines. And then the third mistake I want to talk to you about is that I've kind of alluded to this a little bit. So you might get job offers from places that aren't very desirable to live in. But you might think, you know what? I'm an IMG. And so I'll just take anything. I'll just accept any job and it'll be fine. I'll just stay there for a year or two, maybe 3 years, and then I'll just go somewhere a bit nicer. Don't make that mistake because in the NHS, there are a lot of job offers there. And to be honest, personally, I feel you will always find a job. You might need to do a lot of volunteer work initially just to get to know people, but then you will find that job. And so, what I personally would do is I would do some research into where you want to live in the UK because the UK, it's a small country, but it's wide. Sorry, it's very tall. And life at the tip of Scotland is very different than life on the coast of South England. And so decide what is important for you. If you guys like the seaside, or you like the mountains, or you like big cities, or you want to live in a rural area, or you love the rain and you hate the sun, Scotland is going to be brilliant for you. Then just aim for that. And then once you get there, start looking for jobs there. That's essentially what we did when we went to Australia. You know, I decided I wanted to be in a city. And so I looked at all the cities, and this is kind of non-medical research in a sense. What is a good place to live? You know, what are the benefits of living in this part of the country? What are the benefits of living in this part of the country? And so that was mistake number three. So those are the three mistakes that I made, and hopefully you guys can prevent those. I can see that you have a lot of questions, and I'm really happy about that, but we're going to leave them for the end for the Q&A session.